I got you like Jimmy, don't let it happen. Here's the Mr. Keith Murray, the Mr. Pictionary, the Mr. Quick to fuck shit up in a hurry. On the mic, I squash your little Miss Philosophy with atomic technological atrocity. I find it very ironic that niggas try to ride behind me, the supersonic Dust Squad MC. Get a bird's eye view and don't miss the crispiest nigga in the nucleus with futuristic linguistics. Ballistics be twisted like physics. Niggas be like, how you come up with this shit? But it's automatic, I'm inorganic, with the ability to travel nine planets. Niggas can't understand it. Please, I spark the brain of too many MCs. I'll be more than gladly to take your G's. We can battle for car keys and car titles, house deeds and bank accounts to make it vital. I got what you need. The most homicidal words to come out of a human being. Mind state sick like EDI.
Do what you got to and say what you may.
But niggas gon' come outside, we gon' play anyway. So I'll play the game and let the ball bounce where it may. Run with Death Squad and L-O-D-A.
You can do what you got to and say what you say.
But niggas gon' come outside, we gon' play anyway. So I'll play the game and let the ball bounce where it may. And run with Death Squad and L-O-D-A.
Abracadabra.
Talk shit, I reach right out to grab ya. The hype got you like Jimmy, don't let it have ya. I'm not you skeezers, please, black like Jesus. Never lost in the jungle, navigators with Caesars. Instead, there is a dark side set by red. I'm consciously, cruciously coming for your head. I'm from a small coast called Stay Out My Path. And from a big city called Foot Up In Your Ass. Jeepers, weepers, peepers, get snuffed by the sneakers, throughout the speakers like fisticuffs. Who the fuck is this page of me? Oh, it's my creepy, creepy, grimy, rough rhyme, primey, Reggie. I'm saying, fuck who went where, when, why, and how. Get my shit to me, not now, but right now. Lucky niggas went platinum, think they can see us. We swoop down on crews like angels on dust. I leave your mental so broke you can't pay attention. When I get inside your head and take your brain to another dimension, I'm itching for a scratch and somebody to try to match. The battle cat constantly be on it like that. The doom has dawned in. We knocking niggas out without warning and pissing on them. The configuration is brain cell wasting. Renegades are formed like Africa and Bada in the Zulu nation. You're facing a maniac. Pacing over the track, constantly bringing drama like Jason. In fact, I'm LODing it on Planet Death Squad, putting it down play for play like Amar Rashad. For the cord, I'm wiring joys. Got niggas eating full course meals out of crazy straws. And if it ain't death, it ain't shit. I'm taking it to the limit and killing it each and every minute. Cause Keith Murray takes the beef a major step higher. And peacemakers will get caught in the crossfire. Hip hop's filled with backstabbers, blunt grabbers, cats with dirty claws, dogs with filthy paws. Then you got rap artists claiming to be the hardest. Bust them in their shit and they quick to press charges. Spot rushes, block buses, pocket diamond clusters. Coming to stick the rich out you motherfuckers. Educated black man on premises. LOD and Death Squad forever arch nemesis.
You can do what you gotta do and say what you say.
But niggas gon' come outside and gon' play anyway. So I'll play the game and let the ball bounce where man run with Death Squad and LODA.
You can do what you got to and say what you say.
But niggas gon' come outside, we're gon' play anyway. So I'll play the game and let the ball bounce where it may and run with Death Squad and LODA.
Ah, shit, man. Damn peachy black gangsters are at it again. I wonder who they fucked up tonight.
You motherfucker!
Got him.
Should have been let out the penitentiary. Ice Cube will like to say that I'm a crazy motherfucker from around the way. Since I was a youth, I smoked weed out. Now I'm the motherfucker that you read about taking a life or two. That's what the hell I do. You don't like how I'm living? Well, fuck you. This is a gang, and I'm in it. My man Dre will fuck you up in a minute with a right, left, you're toothless. And then you say, goddamn, they ruthless. Everywhere we go, they say,
damn.
And WA's fucking up the program. And then you realize we don't care. We don't just say no. We're too busy saying yeah. About drinking straight out the 8 bottle. Do I look like a motherfucking role model to a kid looking up to me? Life ain't nothing but bitches and money. Cause I'm the type of nigga that's built to last. If you fuck with me, I put my foot in your ass. See, I don't give a fuck cause I keep belling. Yo, what the fuck are they yelling?
Hear what I have to say.
When me and my posse stepped in the house, all the punk ass niggas start breaking out. Cause you know, they
know what's up. So we start looking for the bitches with the big butt, like her, but she keep crying.
I got a boyfriend.
Bitch, stop lying. Dumb ass hooker ain't nothing but a dyke. Suddenly I see some niggas that I don't like. Walked over to him and said, what's up? The first nigga that I saw hit him in the jaw. Ren start stomping him and so did E. By that time got rushed by security out the door. But we don't end with Ren said, let's start some shit. I got a shotgun and here's the plot. Taking niggas out with a flurry of buckshots. Boom, 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 yeah, I was gunning. And then you look, all you see is niggas running and falling and yelling and pushing and screaming and cussing. I stepped back and I kept bussing. And then I realized it's time for me to go. So I stopped, jumped in the vehicle. It's like this because of that hoot ride. And W ways, one in four homicide. Cause I'm the type of nigga that's built to last. Fuck with me, I put my foot in your ass. See, I don't give a fuck cause I keep belling, belling. Yo, what the fuck are they yelling?
Right on, right on. Thanks so much for being in the building, DOD, man. I really appreciate it, bro. Thanks again, man. So, I don't know if you can hear me okay. Let me see. I'm sure you probably can. I'm sure you probably can. So, my question is, you know, and please hit the like button. Please hit the like button.
I'm sure you probably can.
All right, yeah. So, the first question I want to ask is, what is a redneck? What is redneck? And really, most people think a redneck is somebody from the, you know, I guess the country, drives a Chevy, drinks Mountain Dew. I drink Mountain Dew, crazy, not to drive Chevy. But they do all this stuff, man, and they do, drag racing and demolition derby and whatever, man. But what if... I just want you to kind of change your paradigm, shift your paradigm just for a moment. What if the redneck meant something else? A country bumpkin, right? What if a redneck was something else, man? And so Dr. Thomas Sowell, a lot of people may not know who Dr. Thomas Sowell is. He was actually, he's a conservative economist. He sat on the Friedman Foundation and a few other foundations as well. He is really controversial in some of his viewpoints on race in America, poverty, stuff like that. And I, you know what, actually, the person who we had to thank for this man is DOD. You know, I appreciated DOD, man, for when I saw your answer, Davis, I was like, man, I've been wanting this show, at least part of this. Stuff. This is actually a collection of essays. This book is a collection of essays. I believe it's six of them. And it all addresses redneck behavior exhibited by black folks. And it makes a comparison. So I think this is a very good listen. So we're going to listen to a couple of the essays. And if you have any questions or anything, we'll make any commentary. Please, please, please feel free to put it in the chat. Be more than happy to bring you up and talk about it. All right, man. But I'm only going to be on for an hour. So, yeah. So let's get to it, man. Let's get to it. Yeah, I know, man. I see DOD. Thanks for sharing the video, bro. I really appreciate it, man. Man, you be looking out for me, DOD, man. You my dude, man. You know what I'm saying? DOD been my boy, man, since it was like the first time I made it on Suge panel, man. He was
Blackstone.
Like, he just had a deal, man, he had a beef with white folks. So, all right, man. So let's go ahead and put this on. Patient. And there we go, man. Let's share. Screen's still sharing. Okay, let's go, man.
Black Rednecks and White Liberals by Thomas Sowell. Preface. Race and rhetoric have gone together for so long that it is easy to forget that facts also matter. And these facts often contradict many widely held beliefs. Fantasies and fallacies about racial and ethnic issues have had a particularly painful and deadly history, so exposing some of them is more than an academic exercise. The history of intergroup strife has been written in blood in many countries around the world and across centuries of human history. The purpose of this book is to expose some of the more blatant misconceptions poisoning race relations in our time. The reasons for these misconceptions range from simple, innocent ignorance to reasons that are far from simple and far from innocent. Many of the facts cited here may be surprising or even startling to some readers, but they are not literally unknown to scholars. They have simply not been widely discussed in the media or even in academia. Too much has been assumed for too long, and too little has been scrutinized. It may be optimistic merely to suggest that racial or ethnic issues can be discussed rationally. Evidence to the contrary is all too abundant in the strident and sweeping condemnations directed against many who have tried to do so. Yet there is also evidence in recent years of a growing willingness to consider views that differ from the racial orthodoxy that has prevailed largely unchallenged from the 1960s onward in intellectual circles and in the popular media. In any event, these essays summarize the conclusions of more than a quarter of a century of my research on racial and cultural issues, as well as drawing on the work of innumerable other scholars around the world. These writings do not pretend to be definitive. If they provoke thoughts on a subject where clichés and dogmas too often prevail, then this book will have achieved one of its major goals. However, even a work seeking primarily to untangle a complex set of historic social issues can provoke the fashionable question, "But what is your solution?" Yet, there is not the slightest danger that there will be a shortage of solutions. On the contrary, an abundance of uninformed solutions has been one of our biggest social problems. Any serious consideration of social problems is likely to involve trade-offs rather than neat solutions. And trade-offs depend on values which can vary from one individual to the next. What trade-offs others might make after considering what these essays have to offer is not something that can be predicted, nor is such a prediction necessary. There is still much to be said for the ancient adage, "With all you're getting, get understanding." If this book can contribute to understanding on a subject where misunderstandings abound, then it will have done its work. Because this book is written for the general public, it does not feature long, convoluted sentences with escape clauses designed to prevent words from being twisted to mean something that they were never intended to mean. Common sense can be more readily expected when writing for the general public than when writing for the intelligentsia. To prevent the words in the essays that follow from being stretched, twisted, or given clever meanings, let me state here and now that these essays do not mean that, one, all Southern whites were or are rednecks, that, two, all Black Americans today or in the past were or are Black rednecks, that, three, Jews are exactly the same as the other groups with whom they are compared, or that, four, slavery is somehow morally acceptable because everyone was guilty of it. One cannot predict, much less forestall, all the clever misinterpretations that others might put on one's words. The most that can be done is to alert honest people to the problem. While this book is not particularly large in bulk, its scope is worldwide, and it goes back through centuries. No one can write a book of such scope without incurring many debts to others. These include scholars who devoted much of their careers to the study of some particular specialty, such as the history of agriculture in the southern United States or the origins in Britain of various social groups in America. Such debts are too numerous to list here, quite aside from the danger of implicating other writers in conclusions which are my own. What must be acknowledged is my debt to the Hoover Institution, which has provided the conditions and the support which have facilitated my research and writing for more than two decades. For much of that time, my research assistant, Na Leo, has been an indispensable part of my work, and for this particular book, she has been very ably assisted by the dedicated work of Elizabeth Costa. In the end, however, I must and will take full responsibility for the conclusions reached in the essays that follow. Thomas Sowell, Hoover Institution, Stanford University. Black Rednecks and White Liberals. These people are creating a terrible problem in our cities. They can't or won't hold a job, they flout the law constantly and neglect their children, they drink too much, and their moral standards would shame an alley cat. For some reason or other, they absolutely refuse to accommodate themselves to any kind of decent, civilized life. This was said in 1956 in Indianapolis, not about blacks or other minorities, but about poor whites from the South. Nor was Indianapolis unique in this respect. A 1951 survey in Detroit found that white Southerners living there were considered undesirable by 21% of those surveyed, compared to 13% who ranked blacks the same way. In the late 1940s, a Chicago employer said frankly, "I told the guard at the plant gate to tell the hillbillies that there were no openings." When poor whites from the South moved into northern cities to work in war plants during the Second World War, occasionally, a white Southerner would find that a flat or a furnished room had just been rented when the landlord heard his Southern accent. More is involved here than a mere parallel between blacks and Southern whites. What is involved is a common subculture that goes back for centuries, which has encompassed everything from ways of talking to attitudes toward education, violence, and sex, and which originated not in the South, but in those parts of the British Isles from which white Southerners came. That culture long ago died out where it originated in Britain, while surviving in the American South. Then it largely died out among both white and black Southerners, while still surviving today in the poorest and worst of the urban black ghettos. It is not uncommon for a culture to survive longer where it is transplanted and to retain characteristics lost in its place of origin. The French spoken in Quebec and the Spanish spoken in Mexico contain words and phrases that have long since become archaic in France and Spain. Regional German dialects persisted among Germans living in the United States after those dialects had begun to die out in Germany itself. A scholar specializing in the history of the South has likewise noted among white Southerners archaic word forms, while another scholar has pointed out the continued use in that region of terms that were familiar at the time of the first Queen Elizabeth. The card game whist is today played almost exclusively by blacks, especially low-income blacks, though in the 18th century it was played by the British upper classes and has since then evolved into bridge. The history of the evolution of this game is indicative of a much broader pattern of cultural evolution in much more weighty things. Southern whites not only spoke the English language in very different ways from whites in other regions, their churches, their roads, their homes, their music, their education, their food, and their sex lives were all sharply different from those of other whites. The history of this redneck or cracker culture is more than a curiosity. It has contemporary significance because of its influence on the economic and social evolution of vast numbers of people, millions of blacks and whites, and its continuing influence on the lives and deaths of a residual population in America's black ghettos, which has still not completely escaped from that culture. From early in American history, foreign visitors and domestic travelers alike were struck by cultural contrasts between the white population of the South and that of the rest of the country in general, and of New England in particular. In the early 19th century, Alexis de Tocqueville contrasted white Southerners with white Northerners in his classic Democracy in America, and Frederick Law Olmsted did the same later in his books about his travels through the antebellum South, notably Cotton Kingdom. De Tocqueville set a pattern when he concluded that almost all the differences which may be noticed between the Americans in the Southern and in the Northern states have originated in slavery. Olmsted likewise attributed the differences between white Southerners and white Northerners to the existence of slavery in the South. So did widely read antebellum Southern writer Hinton Helper, who declared that slavery, and nothing but slavery, has retarded the progress and prosperity of our portion of the Union. Just as they explained regional differences between whites by slavery, so many others in a later era would explain differences between blacks and whites nationwide by slavery. Plausible as these explanations may seem in both cases, they will not stand up under a closer scrutiny of history.
It is perhaps understandable that the great overwhelming moral curse of slavery has presented a tempting causal explanation of the peculiar subculture of Southern whites, as well as that of blacks. Yet this same subculture had existed among Southern whites and their ancestors in those parts of the British Isles from which they came, long before they had ever seen a black slave. The nature of this subculture, among people who were called rednecks and crackers in Britain before they ever saw America, needs to be explored before turning to the question of its current status among ghetto blacks and how developments in the larger society have affected its evolution. Redneck culture. Emigration from Britain, like other migrations around the world, was not random in either its origins or its destinations. Most of the Britons who migrated to colonial Massachusetts, for example, came from within a 60-mile radius of the town of Haverhill in East Anglia. The Virginia aristocracy came from different localities in southern and western England. Most of the common white people of the South came from the northern borderlands of England. For centuries, a no-man's land between Scotland and England, as well as from the Scottish Highlands and from Ulster County, Ireland. All these fringe areas were turbulent, if not lawless, regions, where none of the contending forces was able to establish full control and create a stable order. Whether called a Celtic fringe or North Britons, these were people from outside the cultural heartland of England, as their behavior on both sides of the Atlantic showed. Before the era of modern transportation and communication, sharp regional differences were both common and persistent. In some of the counties of colonial Virginia, from nearly three-quarters to four-fifths of the people came from northern Britain, and similar proportions were found in some of the counties of Kentucky and Tennessee, as well as in parts of both the Carolinas. Although they predominated in many parts of the South, such people also had some northern enclaves in colonial America, notably western Pennsylvania, where Ulster Scots settled. What is at least equally important as where particular people settled is when they emigrated from the borderlands, Ulster, and the Scottish Highlands. Scotland in particular progressed enormously in the 18th century. The level from which it began may be indicated by the fact that a visitor to late 18th century Edinburgh found it noteworthy that its residents no longer threw sewage from their chamber pots out their windows into the street, something that passers-by had long had to be alert for, to avoid being splattered. Such crude and unsanitary living had long been characteristic of earlier times, when rural Scots lived in the same primitive shelters with their animals, and vermin abounded. A similar lack of concern with cleanliness was found among others in the borderlands of Britain, and among their descendants on the other side of the Atlantic in the antebellum South. For example, a 19th century politician built up a political machine in the poor white districts of Mississippi by such practices as this. He did not resort to any conventional tactics of kissing dirty babies, but he pleased mothers and fathers in log cabins by taking their children upon his lap and searching for red bugs, lice, and other vermin. Back in the British Isles, the life of the Scottish people was transformed dramatically from the masses to the elites as they advanced from being one of the least educated to one of the most educated peoples in Europe. However, what is significant here is that much of the migration to the American South occurred before these sweeping social transformations. This timing was crucial, as Professor Grady McWiney has pointed out in his book, Cracker Culture. Had the South been peopled by 19th century Scots, Welshmen, and Ulstermen, the course of Southern history would doubtless have been radically different. 19th century Scottish and Scotch-Irish immigrants did in fact fit quite comfortably into Northern American society. Significantly, the Irish, who retained their Celtic ways, did not. But only a trickle of the flood of 19th century immigrants came into the South. The ancestors of the vast majority of Southerners arrived in America before the Anglicization of Scotland, Wales, and Ulster had advanced very far. In earlier centuries, Scotland was a poor and backward country, like Wales and Ireland, and like the turbulent northern borderlands of England, where the Scots and the English fought wars and committed atrocities against each other for centuries. Local feuding clans and freebooting marauders kept this region in an uproar, even when there were no military hostilities between the English and Scottish kingdoms. Ulster County had a different kind of turbulence, as the English and Scottish settlers there encountered the hostility and terrorist activities of the conquered, dispossessed, and embittered indigenous Irish population. These were the parts of Britain from which most people migrated to the American South, before the political and cultural unification of the British Isles or the standardization of the English language. The rednecks of these regions were what one social historian has called some of the most disorderly inhabitants of a deeply disordered land. In this world of impotent laws, daily dangers, and lives that could be snuffed out at any moment, the snatching at whatever fleeting pleasures presented themselves was at least understandable. Certainly, prudence and long-range planning of one's life had no such payoff in this chaotic world as in more settled and orderly societies under the protection of effective laws. Books, businesses, technology, and science were not the kinds of things likely to be promoted or admired in the world of the rednecks and crackers. Manliness, and the forceful projection of that manliness to others, and advertising of one's willingness to fight, and even to put one's life on the line, were at least plausible means of gaining whatever measure of security was possible in a lawless region and a violent time. The kinds of attitudes and cultural values produced by centuries of living under such conditions did not disappear very quickly, even when social evolution in North America slowly and almost imperceptibly created a new and different world with different objective prospects. What the rednecks or crackers brought with them across the ocean was a whole constellation of attitudes, values, and behavior patterns that might have made sense in the world in which they had lived for centuries, but which would prove to be counterproductive in the world to which they were going, and counterproductive to the blacks who would live in their midst for centuries before emerging into freedom and migrating to the great urban centers of the United States, taking with them similar values. The cultural values and social patterns prevalent among Southern whites included an aversion to work, proneness to violence, neglect of education, sexual promiscuity, improvidence, drunkenness, lack of entrepreneurship, reckless searches for excitement, lively music and dance, and a style of religious oratory marked by strident rhetoric, unbridled emotions, and flamboyant imagery. This oratorical style carried over into the political oratory of the region in both the Jim Crow era and the Civil Rights era, and has continued on into our own times among black politicians, preachers, and activists. Touchy pride, vanity, and boastful self-dramatization were also part of this redneck culture among people from regions of Britain where the civilization was the least developed. "They boast and lack self-restraint," Olmsted said, after observing their descendants in the American antebellum South. While Professor Grady McWiney's Cracker Culture is perhaps the most thorough historical study of the values and behavioral patterns of white Southerners, many other scholarly studies have turned up very similar patterns, even when they differed in some ways as to the causes. Professor David Hackett Fisher's Albion Seed, for example, challenges the Celtic connection thesis put forth by Professor McWiney, but shows many of the same cultural patterns among the same people, both in Britain and in the American South. Popular writings of the 19th and 20th centuries have likewise described similar behavior, including the Indianapolis residents' comments on white Southern migrants to that city, which sounds so much like what many have said about ghetto blacks. None of this is meant to claim that these patterns have remained rigidly unchanged over the centuries, or that there are literally no differences between whites and blacks in any aspects of this subculture. However, what is remarkable is how pervasive and how close the similarities have been. Pride and violence. Centuries before black pride became a fashionable phrase, there was cracker pride, and it was very much the same kind of pride. It was not pride in any particular achievement or set of behavioral standards or moral principles adhered to. It was instead a touchiness about anything that might be even remotely construed as a personal slight, much less an insult, combined with a willingness to erupt into violence over it. New Englanders were baffled about this kind of pride among crackers. Observing such people, the Yankees could not understand what they had to feel proud about. However, This kind of pride is perhaps best illustrated by an episode reported in Professor McWiney's Cracker Culture. When an Englishman, tired of waiting for a Southerner to start working on a house he had contracted to build, hired another man to do the job, the enraged Southerner, who considered himself dishonored, vowed, "Tomorrow morn, I will come with men and 20 rifles, and I will have your life, or you shall have mine." In the vernacular of our later times, he had been dissed, and he was not going to stand for it, regardless of the consequences for himself or others. The history of the antebellum South is full of episodes showing the same pattern, whether expressed in the highly formalized duels of the aristocracy or in the no-holds-barred style of fighting called rough and tumble among the common folk, a style that included biting off ears and gouging out eyes. It was not simply that particular isolated individuals did such things. Social approval was given to these practices, as illustrated by this episode in the antebellum South. A crowd gathered and arranged itself in an impromptu ring. The contestants were asked if they wished to fight fair or rough and tumble. When they chose rough and tumble, a roar of approval rose from the multitude. This particular fight ended with the loser's nose bitten off, his ears torn off, and both his eyes gouged out, after which the victor himself, maimed and bleeding, was chaired round the grounds to the cheers of the crowd. This rough and tumble style of fighting was also popular in the southern highlands of Scotland, where grabbing an opponent's testicles and attempting to castrate him by hand was also an accepted practice. Scottish Highlanders were, in centuries past, part of the Celtic fringe, or North Britons, outside the orbit of English culture, not only as it existed in England, but also in the Scottish lowlands. The Highlanders lagged far behind the Lowlanders in education and economic progress, as well as in the speaking of the English language, for Gaelic was still widely spoken by Highlanders in the 19th century, not only in Scotland itself, but also in North Carolina and in Australia, where immigrants from the Scottish Highlands were unable to communicate with English-speaking people, including Lowland Scots who had also immigrated. In the Hebrides Islands off Scotland, Gaelic had still not completely died out in the middle of the 20th century. What is important in the pride and violence patterns among rednecks and crackers was not that particular people did particular things at particular times and places, nor is it necessary to attempt to quantify such behavior. What is crucial is that violence growing out of such pride had social approval. As Professor McWiney pointed out, men often killed and went free in the South, just as in earlier times they had in Ireland and Scotland. As one observer in the South noted, enemies would meet, exchange insults, and one would shoot the other down, professing that he had acted in self-defense because he believed the victim was armed. When such a story was told in court, in a community where it is not a strange thing for men to carry about their persons deadly weapons, each member of the jury feels that he would have done the same thing under similar circumstances, so that in condemning him, they would but condemn themselves. The actions of Southern courts often amazed outsiders, Professor McWiney said. But what may be even more revealing of widespread attitudes were the cases that never even went to trial. As another study of white Southerners put it, to many rural Southerners, rather than a set of legal statutes, justice remained a matter of societal norms allowing for respect of property rights, individual honor, and a maximum of personal independence. Any violation of this pattern amounted to a breach of justice requiring a specific response from the injured party. Upon learning that a youthful neighbor had approached his wife in an overly friendly manner, Robert Leard of Tangipahoa, Louisiana, promptly tracked the young man down and killed him. Under the Piney Woods Code of Justice, anything less would have invited shame and ridicule upon the Leard family. Intensity of personal pride was connected by Olmsted with the fiend-like street fights of the South. He mentioned an episode of public murder with impunity. A gentleman of veracity, now living in the South, told me that among his friends he had once numbered two young men who were themselves intimate friends, till one of them, taking offense at some foolish words uttered by the other, challenges him. A large crowd assembled to see the duel, which took place on a piece of prairie ground. The combatants came armed with rifles, and at the first interchange of shots, the challenged man fell disabled by a ball in the thigh. The other, throwing down his rifle, walked toward him, and kneeling by his side, drew a bowie knife and deliberately butchered him. The crowd of bystanders not only permitted this, but the execrable assassin still lives in the community, has since married, and, as far as my informant could judge, his social position has been rather advanced than otherwise, from thus dealing with his enemy. Again, what is important here is not the isolated incident itself, but the set of social attitudes which allowed such incidents to take place publicly with impunity. The killer knowing in advance that what he was doing had community approval. Moreover, such attitudes went back for centuries on both sides of the Atlantic, at least among the particular people concerned. During the era when dueling became a pattern among upper-class Americans, between the Revolutionary War and the Civil War, it was particularly prevalent in the South. As a social history of the United States noted, of Southern statesmen who rose to prominence after 1790, hardly one can be mentioned who was not involved in a duel. Editors of Southern newspapers became involved in duels so often that cartoonists depicted them with a pen in one hand and a dueling pistol in the other. Most duels arose not over substantive issues, but over words considered insulting. At lower social levels, Southern feuds such as that between the Hatfields and the McCoys, which began in a dispute over a pig and ultimately claimed more than 20 lives, became legendary. It has been estimated that, while at least three-quarters of the settlers in colonial New England originated in the lowland southeastern half of Britain, a similarly large proportion of the population of the South originated in the Scottish Highlands, Ireland, Wales, or the northern and western uplands of England. Those arriving from Ireland in colonial times would have been from Ulster County, where Scots and Englishmen settled, since substantial immigration of the indigenous Irish did not begin until near the middle of the 19th century. Radically different cultures could develop and persist during this era before transportation and communication developed to the point of promoting widespread interactions among people in different regions. In colonial America, the people of the English borderlands and of the Celtic fringe were seen by contemporaries as culturally quite distinct and were socially unwelcome. Mob action prevented a shipload of Ulster Scots from landing in Boston in 1719, and the Quaker leaders of eastern Pennsylvania encouraged Ulster Scots to settle out in western Pennsylvania, where they acted as a buffer to the Indians, as well as being a constant source of friction and conflict with the Indians. It was not just in the North that crackers and rednecks were considered to be undesirables. Southern plantation owners with poor whites living on adjoining land would often offer to buy their land for more than it was worth in order to be rid of such neighbors. Because there were no racial differences to form separate statistical categories for these North Britons and for other whites who settled in the South, or in particular enclaves elsewhere, indirect indicators must serve as proxies for these cultural differences. Names are among these indicators. Edward, for example, was a popular name in Virginia and in Wessex, England, from which many Virginians had emigrated. But the first 40 classes of undergraduates at Harvard College contained only one man named Edward. It would be nearly two centuries before Harvard enrolled anyone named Patrick, even though that was a common name in western Pennsylvania where the Ulster Scots settled. This says something not only about the social and geographic differences of the times, but also about how regionalized the naming patterns were then, in contrast to the fact that no one today finds it particularly strange when an Asian American has such non-Asian first names as Kevin or Michelle. Even where there was no conflict or hostility involved, Southerners often showed a reckless disregard for human life, including their own. For example, the racing of steamboats that happened to encounter each other on the rivers of the South often ended with exploding boilers, especially when the excited competition led to the tying down of safety valves in order to build up more pressure to generate more speed. An impromptu race between steamboats that encountered each other on the Mississippi illustrates the pattern. On board one boat was an old lady who, having bought a winter stock of bacon, pork, etc., was returning to her home on the banks of the Mississippi. Fun lovers on board both boats insisted upon a race. Cheers and drawn pistols obliged the captains to cooperate. As the boats struggled to outdistance each other, excited passengers demanded more speed. Despite every effort, the boats raced evenly until the old lady directed her slaves to throw all her casks of bacon into the boilers. Her boat then moved ahead of the other vessel, which suddenly exploded. Clouds of splinters and human limbs darkened the sky. On the undamaged boat, passengers shouted their victory. But above their cheers could be heard the shrill voice of the old lady crying, "I did it! I did it! It's all my bacon!" On the Mississippi and other western rivers of the United States, as it existed in the early 19th century, it has been estimated that 30% of all the steamboats were lost in accidents. Part of this may have been due to deficiencies in the early steamboats themselves, but much of it was due to the recklessness with which they were operated on southern rivers. The comments of a fireman on a Mississippi steamboat of that era may suggest why a river voyage was considered more dangerous than crossing the Atlantic, at a time when sinkings in the Atlantic were by no means rare. "Talk about northern steamers," the fireman of a Mississippi steamboat sneered to an eastern traveler in 1844. "You don't need no spunk to navigate them waters. You ain't bust a biler in 5 years. But I tell you, stranger, it takes a man to ride one of these half-alligator boats, head on a snag, high pressures, valve soldered down, 600 souls on board, and in danger of going to the devil." This was no mere idle talk. Among the steamboat explosions in the South, one on the Mississippi in 1838 killed well over 100 people, and another near Baton Rouge in 1859 killed more than half of the 400 people on board and badly injured more than half the survivors. Southerners were just as reckless on land, whether in escapades undertaken for the excitement of the moment or in the many fights and deaths resulting from some insult or slight among people touchy about their honor and dignity. Again, all of this went back to a way of life in the turbulent regions of Britain from which white Southerners came. Nor is it hard to recognize in these attitudes clear parallels to the behavior and attitudes of ghetto gangs today, who kill over a look or a word or any action that can be construed as dissing them. Pride had yet another side to it. Among the definitions of a cracker in the Oxford Dictionary is a braggart, one who talks trash in today's vernacular, a wisecracker. More than mere wisecracks were involved, however. The pattern is one said by Professor McWiney to go back to descriptions of ancient Celts as boasters and threateners and given to bombastic self-dramatization. Examples today come readily to mind, not only from ghetto life and gangster rap, but also from militant black leaders, spokesmen, or activists. What is painfully ironic is that such attitudes and behavior are projected today as aspects of a distinctive black identity, when in fact, they are part of a centuries-old pattern among the whites in whose midst generations of blacks lived in the South. Any broad-brush discussion of cultural patterns must, of course, not claim that all people, whether white or black, had the same culture, much less to the same degree. There are not only changes over time, there are cross-currents at any given time. Nevertheless, it is useful to see the outlines of a general pattern, even when that pattern erodes over time and at varying rates among different subgroups. The violence for which white Southerners became most lastingly notorious was lynching. Like other aspects of the redneck and cracker culture, it has often been attributed to race or slavery. In fact, however, most lynching victims in the antebellum South were white. Economic considerations alone would prevent a slave owner from lynching his own slave or tolerating anyone else's doing so. It was only after the Civil War that the emancipated blacks became the principal targets of lynching. But by then, Southern vigilante violence had been a tradition for more than a century in North America, and even longer back in the regions of Britain from which crackers and rednecks came, where retributive justice was often left in private hands. Even the burning cross of the Ku Klux Klan has been traced back to the fiery cross of Old Scotland, used by feuding clans. Economic activity. Observers of the white population of the antebellum South often commented not only on their poverty, but also on their lack of industriousness or entrepreneurship. A contemporary characterized many white Southerners as too poor to keep slaves and too proud to work. A landmark history of agriculture in the antebellum South described the poor whites this way. They cultivated in a casual and careless fashion small patches of corn or rice, sweet potatoes, cowpeas, and garden products. Women and children did a large part of the work. The men spent their time principally in hunting or idleness. The men were inveterate drunkards, and sometimes the women joined them in drinking inferior whiskey. Licentiousness was prevalent among them. Among their equals, the men were quarrelsome and inclined to crimes of violence. The poor whites were densely ignorant. Their labors tended to be intermittent, often with
what does that sound like, y'all? Hey, Celestial, hey, you know what to do with them cats, man. Get them up out of here, man. But who does that sound like? It sounds like a lot like some of the people who are in the chat right now giving thumbs down. They have that same type of behavior. It's actually a retarded behavior. As you can see, this is something that the Highlanders of Scotland and Ireland and the British Isles have been doing for hundreds of years. So when we have these black folks that come in and they act a fool, and they're boastful and practice licentiousness, and the men are not working or not taking care of the children. All they're doing is just following the blueprint. And if you think about it, 28%, I think on average, of every African American, 28% of that, 28%, they have 20% like Irish, Scottish, or something. So really, the behaviors that we are seeing today are the behaviors of the fathers and the mothers of these black kids back 100 years ago. It's wild, isn't it? I mean, it's just really wild. If you think about it, man, it's really wild. So let's go ahead and let's get back to it real quick. I'm going to play just a little bit more, probably another 10, 15 minutes. And I got some other stuff to do.
When they were pressed for money rather than a steady employment career.
Hear that?
Frederick Law Olmsted called it lazy poverty, with whatever work they did being done in a thoughtless manner. Summarizing his observations in the antebellum South, Olmsted said, I know that while men seldom want an abundance of coarse food in the cotton states, the proportion of the free white men who live as well in any aspect as our working classes in the North, on an average, is small, and that the citizens of the cotton states, as a whole, are poor. They work little, and that little, badly. They earn little, they sell little, they buy little, and they have little, very little, of the common comforts and consolations of civilized life. Their destitution is not material only, it is intellectual and it is moral. When Olmsted found work done efficiently, promptly, and well during his travels,
destitute. That's the behavior that we're seeing right now. When somebody who will come in this chat right now, and if they would hit the thumb down on this, on what we're talking about, on this topic, you got to ask yourself, man, who are these people? And then you laugh, right? I mean, you literally laugh, man. So they're taking a chance to where they could actually learn something about their, just as that kind of an anthropological economic study on race in America. They're spending time on some fuck shit. I can't, but it is what it is, right? And you'll see why. Listen to this.
Through the South, when he found well-run businesses, good libraries, impressive churches, and efficiently functioning institutions in general, he almost invariably found them to be run by Northerners, foreigners, or Jews. Nor was he the only visiting observer to reach such conclusions. Another observed that nearly all of the Old South's successful storekeepers were either Yankees or Yankee-trained Southerners. A French visitor said that when you saw a plantation in better condition than others, you would often discover that it was owned by someone from the North. A history of Southern agriculture presented this picture of North Carolina in the early 18th century. Many of the inhabitants were rough borderers who lived a crude, half-savage existence. Some were herdsmen, dependent mainly on the product of the range and under the necessity of eating meat without bread. There were also many thriftless and lazy families who had been attracted to the country by the mild climate and the ease with which a bare livelihood could be obtained by hunting and fishing, raising a little corn and keeping a few head of swine, and possibly a cow or two on the range. On the other hand, there were small farmers, many of northern or European extraction, living industrious and thrifty lives amidst a rude abundance and considerable diversity of food supplies. They maintained good-sized herds of cattle, swine, and sheep, and the women made butter and cheese. Borderers, at that point, would refer to people from the borderlands of Britain, those included in what Professor McWiney and others have called the Celtic Fringe, and what Professor Fisher called North Britons. While the making of butter and cheese might seem to be an unremarkable activity in most rural communities, butter and cheese making by these farmers of non-Southerner origins was in fact exceptional in the South. One of Frederick Law Olmsted's complaints during his travels through the antebellum South was the scarcity of butter, despite all the cows he saw. Even among plantation owners, he said, as for butter, some have heard of it, some have seen it, but few have eaten it. Hard data support his conclusions about the scarcity of butter in the antebellum South, despite an abundance of cows. In 1860, the South had 40% of all the dairy cows in the country, but produced just 20% of the butter and only 1% of the cheese. As a study of antebellum Southern agriculture noted, attempts to stimulate greater attention to commercial production were futile, and even the bluegrass regions imported a large proportion of the cheese consumed. The study concluded, in short, while the South abounded in cattle, the reported production of dairy products was very small. A table based on census statistics shows that some of the Southern states, such as Texas and Florida, had far more cattle per capita than important dairy states like Vermont and New York. And in most of the Southern states, cattle per capita were nearly or quite as numerous as in the Northern states. Yet the production of butter and cheese per capita in most of the Southern states was insignificant as compared with per capita production in the principal Northeastern states. A speaker before an agricultural society in Orange County, North Carolina, said, "It is a reproach to us as farmers, and no little deduction from our wealth, that we suffer the population of our towns and villages to supply themselves with butter from another Orange County in New York." In colonial times, butter was imported from as far away as Ireland. Where butter was not imported, it was often produced locally by people of non-Southern origins. As a scholarly history of Southern agriculture reported, in 1858, the dairies producing whole milk for the city of Louisville, Kentucky, were described as probably as well conducted as any in the country, but almost without exception, managed by Swiss or German operatives. Meanwhile, a newspaper in South Carolina said in 1857, "Good butter is indeed a luxury to almost every planter in the Southern country, and there is, perhaps, no one article of food that is more eagerly sought after." In antebellum Virginia, a Richmond newspaper likewise complained of the scarcity of good butter, saying that the quality of butter available in the local market would hardly be thought good enough to grease a cartwheel. When considering legislation to try to remedy the situation, a member of the Virginia legislature attributed the poor quality of that state's butter to the carelessness with which Virginia farmers prepared it. One reason for the contrast between the abundance of butter and cheese produced by German farmers in states like Wisconsin, for example, and the scarcity of butter and cheese in the South was that German farmers, wherever they were located, tended to build fences and huge barns for their livestock and to feed them there during the winter. Southerners more often let their cows and hogs roam freely during the winter, even though this meant that in the spring they turned up half-starved and it took the summer for them to put on normal weight. This, too, was a continuation of patterns found among their ancestors in the British Isles and was part of a more general pattern of carelessness. Many other observers noticed the broken fences and the stunted cattle running at large, unfed and unprotected. Their manure was put to no use.
Artificial pasture long remained a rarity, and few farmers stored feed for the winter.
Don't this sound like the hood, man? I mean, really, if you really kind of juxtapose with today, don't this sound like a hood, man?
Winter. In Virginia, a French traveler of the late 17th century saw poor beasts of a morning all covered with snow and trembling with the cold, but no forage was provided for them.
They eat the bark of the trees because the grass was covered. Wild animals, wolves, bears, and savage dogs attacked the helpless cattle and made the raising of sheep difficult. Germans were better able than Southerners to milk their cows regularly and prepare dairy products, while cows owned by Southerners were more likely to run dry after calves were weaned. A contemporary observer said that even Southern farmers with many cows will not give themselves the trouble of milking more than will maintain their family. As late as the 1930s, a scholar studying the geography and economy of the South wrote, "The close attention to duty, the habits of steady, skillful routine accepted by butterfat producers of Wisconsin as a matter of fact, are traits not yet present in Southern culture." At that point, the Southern states, with 26% of the country's dairy cows, produced just 7% of processed dairy products such as butter, cheese, ice cream, and condensed milk. There was a similar contrast between German farmers and Southern farmers when it came to clearing land for farming back in pioneering days. Germans cleared frontier land by both chopping down trees and laboriously removing their stumps and roots so that all the land could be plowed thereafter. Southerners more often cut down the tree or even simply girdled it and left it to die and rot, but in any case, leaving the stump in the ground and plowing around it. Although the erosion-prone soils of the southern uplands have been blamed for the poverty of the whites living on them, nevertheless, on that same land, Germans were able to cultivate the hill soil so as to avoid erosion and were willing to expend upon it the additional labor which its topography required, so that these soils in their hands yielded excellent regular returns. Comments on the lack of enterprise by Southern whites were made by numerous observers in various parts of the South. In Alexis de Tocqueville's classic Democracy in America, he contrasted the attitudes toward work among Southern and Northern whites as being so great as to be visible to the casual observer sailing down the Ohio River and comparing the Ohio side with the Kentucky side. These were not just the prejudices of outsiders. "No Southern man," South Carolina's famed Senator John C. Calhoun said, "not even the poorest or the lowest, will, under any circumstances, perform menial labor. He has too much pride for that." General Robert E. Lee likewise declared, "Our people are opposed to work. Our troops, officers, community, and press, all ridiculed and resisted." Many whites, according to a leading Southern historian, were disposed to leave good enough alone and put off changes till the morrow. Very similar kinds of comments were made about these Southerners' ancestors in the parts of the British Isles from which they came. Although the term lazy appears frequently in comments on these people on both sides of the Atlantic, there has been no evidence of any such aversion on their part to strenuous physical activity in dancing, fighting, hunting, and other recreational activities, so sloth was not the real issue. Nor have rednecks or crackers been prominent in such less physically demanding activities as entrepreneurship or scholarship. It is the nature of the particular activities in which they have taken an active interest and on which they have expended their energies, rather than the physical demands of those activities, that seems to have been crucial. Not only did many of the groups who settled in the South disdain business as a career, as their ancestors had in those parts of Britain from which they came, they typically lacked the kinds of habits necessary to be successful in business. Among the habits needed to run a business, none is more basic than a steady application to the tasks at hand, doing things in a business-like way. but those relatively few Southerners who did run businesses often displayed no such business-like attitudes. Even when there was business to transact, Southerners would often stop to go watch a cockfight or a parade, or visit a saloon, or go hunting. In traveling in the South, a Northern visitor commented in the 1850s, "You become astonished at the little attention men pay to their business." Such views were not confined to Northerners, however, nor to urban businesses. According to a noted history of the antebellum South, the Richmond Inquirer attributed the success of Northern farmers where Southerners had failed to the social nature of the latter, which led them to gather around the courthouse and country stores to smoke, chew, talk politics, and in general, to waste time. Many Southern businessmen were unreliable about either paying their bills or delivering goods and services when promised. Among Southerners in general, their improvident spending and the indebtedness to which it often led was widely commented on in the United States and in the places from which their ancestors came in Britain. Even large Southern plantation owners with lavish lifestyles were often deeply in debt. Among the Virginia gentry, extravagant and even ruinous bets on horses were common, according to a scholarly study. Nor were Southerners alert to profitable investment prospects, according to observers in the antebellum South. For example, although there were large coal deposits and a beautiful quality of marble near Tuscaloosa, Alabama, the people there bought coal from Philadelphia, and marble for tombstones was imported from Italy. In antebellum Virginia as well, Olmsted observed the natural resources of the land were strangely unused or were used with poor economy. Nor was he alone in that conclusion. A 20th century scholar also commented on the coal available in Alabama. "The Alabama Iron District is one of the cheapest, if not the cheapest, iron district in the entire world. It possesses a phenomenal natural equipment. Jutting out of the hillsides that flank one side of the broad, open valley are thick deposits of iron ore. On the other side of the valley are the coal mines and coke ovens, and the limestone is at hand. Instead of carrying ore 1,000 miles, as at Pittsburgh and the English furnaces, or fuel 600 miles, as at Lake Champlain, the raw materials for these southern furnaces are shifted across the valley by switching engines, and the local supply of cheap black labor helps to give a wonderful low cost." Yet it was more than 20 years after the Civil War before Birmingham became an iron and steel production center. As for the reasons for the belated development of such a promising combination of natural resources, in spite of the favors of geography, the iron and steel industry in the South was slow in its beginnings and development.
So there you go, y'all. That's the first few chapters, man, of Black Rednecks and White Liberals, man. I'm going to keep doing this, man. Keep playing this book. I think it is something that, you know, Black, it's like if you understand the source of your problems, then it's easier to solve those problems rather than trying to guess around, you know, what those problems are, you know, what, you know, where those problems came from. You know, you see people who are, who don't care to take care of their children, who are lazy, slothful, you know, just all around just not good people. It's because, y'all right on, Deacon, I will keep playing it, man. I'm gonna start playing it probably every day, man. Probably playing every day, man. So yeah. Thanks, man, for coming and chilling out, man. Thanks, Upper Unicorn, for coming in. You know, thanks, Bebo Toy, A and Clee. Appreciate it. Appreciate it. Appreciate you coming in. So you guys be easy. And this is what we're gonna do. You know how we gotta end it off here, right? Reverend, and said, boom.
I was thinking. Last night, about this case and their theory and how it didn't make any sense and how it didn't fit and how something is wrong. And it occurred to me how they were going to come here and stand up here and tell you how O.J. Simpson was going to disguise himself. Was going to put on a knit cap and some dark clothes, and he was going to get in his white Bronco and this recognizable person and go over and kill his wife. That's what they want you to believe. That's how silly their argument is. And I said to myself, maybe I can demonstrate this graphically. Let me show you something. This is a knit cap. I'm gonna put this knit cap on. And you've been seeing me for a year. If I put this knit cap on, who am I? I'm still Johnny Cochran with a knit cap. And if you look at O.J. Simpson over there, and he has a rather large head, O.J. Simpson in a knit cap from two blocks away is still O.J. Simpson. It's no disguise. It's no disguise. It makes no sense. It doesn't fit. If it doesn't fit, you must acquit.
There you go, man. It's no disguise, man. It makes no sense. Man, that's dope, man. All right, man. That plays one thing. My aunt, I tried to call her today, man. So I was like, hey, yeah, Jack, yeah, I'll be playing this thing for you. You know what I'm saying?
And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee. Thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen. And no man shall buy you. No one will buy your freedom. Then the Lord said to him, know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. But I will punish the nation that they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. So then the days are coming, declares the Lord, when people will no longer say, as surely as the Lord lives who brought the Israelites out of Egypt, but they will say, as surely as the Lord lives who brought the descendants out of Israel, out of the land of the north and out of all the countries where he had banished them, then they will live in their own land.
All right, y'all, man. Good night.